Born into slavery, Dred Scott, along with his wife Harriett, legally sued for his freedom in 1846. The Supreme Court decision that followed was one of the sparks that led to the Civil War. This is the messed up truth about the Dred Scott case. Like so many other enslaved people, the exact details of Dred Scott's early life are vague and hard to uncover. We do know that he was born sometime around 1795 in Virginia. Though he was born into slavery, it's not clear if the Blow family was the first to claim ownership over him. However, he did work for them fairly early on in his life. Scott's original name was allegedly Sam, but upon the death of an older brother, he took the name Dred in his honor. Scott would spend a significant portion of his life moving around the country at the behest of his masters, beginning with the Blow family's move to Huntsville, Alabama. Family patriarch Peter Blow had attempted to farm there, but upon failing, moved to St. Louis, Missouri. Scott was apparently obliged to move with them as Blow started running a boarding house. Sometime shortly before or directly after Peter Blow's 1832 death, Scott was then sold to Dr. John Emerson. Though he was originally a civilian doctor, Emerson would eventually become an assistant surgeon for the U.S. Army. This meant a move to a posting in Illinois, which was a free state that had outlawed slavery. Given that Emerson took Dred Scott with him, this move would eventually form the bedrock of Scott's petition for his freedom. In 1820, the Missouri Compromise was a national settlement on the matter of slavery. However, it created more tension over the issue that already had deep political and ethical divides. The settlement was linked to the westward expansion of Americans into new territory and the question of whether or not new territories and states should allow slavery within their borders. In 1819, Representative James Talmadge of New York proposed that Missouri could only gain statehood if it stopped importing slaves. In addition, all children born to Missouri slaves would then be free. Congressional politics struck out Talmadge's plan, but enough members of the House supported the move that something had to be done. And so Speaker of the House Henry Clay came up with what was known as the Missouri Compromise. Per Clay's plan, Missouri would be admitted as a slave state, but Maine would be a free state to effectively balance it all out. Later, adjustments to the plan meant that slavery was banned in all U.S. lands bought via the Louisiana Purchase. The boundary line happened to run just south of Missouri. Naturally, the compromise pleased almost no one. In 1854, it was repealed by the Kansas-Nebraska Act, yet the legacy of the Missouri Compromise was far from over. The Missouri Compromise was still very much in effect when Dred Scott moved to the slave state of Missouri in the 1830s, but things got complicated when Scott moved to Illinois with Dr. John Emerson. Illinois was a free state where slavery was banned. A second move to the Wisconsin Territory also meant that Scott found himself in yet another region that had banned slavery. At this point, Scott met and married another enslaved person, Harriett Robinson. Harriett's owner transferred the ownership to Emerson, allowing the newlyweds to stay together. Emerson then hired them out as he went south to Louisiana and eventually got married. According to the National Park Service, the Scotts were recalled to join Emerson in St. Louis in 1842. For much of this time, neither Scott nor his wife Harriett formally petitioned for their freedom, though they had the legal standing to do so. It could be that, with two young daughters, Dred and Harriett weren't inclined to cause trouble and risk splitting up their family. They may also have been kept unaware of the Missouri Compromise or how they could legally petition for their own freedom. On April 6, 1846, both Dred and Harriett Scott each filed a suit against Irene Emerson, the widow of Dr. John Emerson and the woman who was probably their owner at the time. The couple were also arguing for the freedom of their two daughters, Eliza and Lizzie. The Scotts had apparently been living in St. Louis for much of the time, being hired out to the Emerson family members and other people in the community. However, records of their movements are incomplete, even in the later court records that make it all the way to the United States Supreme Court. There are multiple situations that may have led the Scotts to file at the time they did. It could be that Irene Emerson was thinking about selling them, possibly breaking up their young family in the process. It may even be that Dred had earlier attempted to buy his freedom from Emerson, but that he had been denied. At the time they filed their suits in 1846, Harriett and Dred Scott were unable to read or write, and the U.S. court system was complicated and not for people from all walks of life. The Scotts were unable to read about the Missouri Compromise and local laws. Plus, they were unable to write for help, and so they likely wouldn't have known how to gain their freedom through the courts. So to bring their case before a court, the Scotts needed legal help from other people. These included local St. Louis abolitionists, members of their church, and surprisingly, members of the Blow family. This is the very same Blow family who had previously owned the Scotts. Since the time the Blows had sold Dred Scott to when they came back in contact with him, some family members had begun to move towards the anti-slavery cause. The original 1846 suits filed at St. Louis's old courthouse were only the beginning of what would prove to be a long and hard road for the Scotts. They lost their first case due to a technicality, but this 1847 defeat didn't stop the Scots. In 1850, the Missouri Supreme Court allowed a second trial, which resulted in the Scots being granted freedom. Irene Emerson quickly appealed the decision. During this time, the Scott family moved between legally enslaved and free. Their status was perpetually uncertain. But then the Missouri Supreme Court came down firmly on the side of Emerson, declaring the Scots to once again be her property. Furthermore, the court declared that it would not enforce the rules of free states.
You ain't a free man.
More challenges occurred from there. Some courts went so far as to say that Scott and his family were not American citizens to begin with, and so didn't have the right to sue in the first place. Finally, in 1856, the numerous challenges, appeals, and upending back and forth made it all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States. Dred Scott versus Sandford was finally reviewed by the Supreme Court in 1856, although the justices did not announce their decision until the following year. Many were shaken to hear that the court ruled against Dred Scott. The court also declared that all black Americans were non-citizens. They even said that the federal government had no right to free slaves or make legislation concerning the matter, and so the court ultimately dismissed in a 7-2 majority. Because black Americans were supposedly non-citizens, the majority ruling held that a federal court had no business ruling for or against the non-citizen's claim for freedom. The decision sought to strip the Scots of any rights they hoped to have, but the Supreme Court also declared the Missouri Compromise invalid. In his dissenting opinion, Justice Benjamin Robinson Curtis asked what the court was doing by making decisions about the Missouri Compromise. Justice John McLean also chimed in, noting that the decision didn't make sense given that black men had the right to vote in 5 states at the time. A closer look at the individual justices who ruled in the Dred Scott decision uncovers some potentially serious biases which seem to have influenced the 1857 ruling. 7 of the 9 Supreme Court justices were appointed by presidents who favored slavery. A further 5 were from slave-owning families themselves. However, Chief Justice Roger B. Taney presents one of the more complicated figures in the whole affair. Judging from this case, he appears to be pro-slavery, to the point where he would deny Scott citizenship. Further, he would consider him and his family to be another person's property. Yet Taney's personal beliefs presented a stark contrast to his actions on the bench. He was devoutly religious, to the point where he believed that slavery was evil and should eventually be done away with entirely. To that end, Taney had even freed his own slaves before becoming a Supreme Court justice. But there was another bias allegedly at work, as historians believe incoming president-elect James Buchanan secretly pressured the justices to rule against Scott in what was a massive ethical and legal breach. Justice Taney reportedly had hoped the decision to strike down the Missouri Compromise would settle the slavery debate forever and bring peace to America. Instead, the opposite happened. In the wake of the Supreme Court's decision, abolitionists were incensed. Many Americans were enraged that black Americans were anything less than full citizens. And so the result of Dred Scott versus Sandford was a stark wake-up call. Meanwhile, those who supported the institution of slavery celebrated. And all the while, the divide between the two groups was growing ever wider and more violent. This was also the time of Bleeding Kansas, which was the ongoing conflict from 1855 to 1859 between pro-slavery and anti-slavery factions in the Kansas Territory. It was a dramatically violent conflict, to the point where even lawmakers in Washington, D.C. came to blows over the matter. In 1856, South Carolina Representative Preston Brooks beat Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner with a cane on the floor of the Senate, leaving Sumner bleeding and unconscious. The incident, rather predictably, led to even further polarization on both sides. This tumult led anti-slavery Northerners to nominate Abraham Lincoln as Republican candidate. He then won the election to the White House. Eventually, the growing divide in Lincoln's presence at the seat of government led to the secession of the South from the rest of the nation. And this was the beginning of the American Civil War. After the Supreme Court decision, Scott, his wife, and 2 daughters were considered property again. But Irene Sandford had remarried her second husband, Dr. Calvin Chappie, who was an abolitionist. He was also pretty unhappy with being associated with one of the most dramatic and controversial cases to make it to the U.S. Supreme Court. It didn't help that he was both an abolitionist and, thanks to his marriage, the newest owner of Dred Scott. So shortly after the Supreme Court handed down its non-decision, Chappie leaned on his wife to free the Scott family. The Chappies quickly transferred ownership of the Scotts to Taylor Blow of the St. Louis Blow family. That was the same family who had previously owned Scott decades ago. Missouri state law at the time had made it so that only state residents could free slaves there. Taylor Blow quickly freed them, and the St. Louis Circuit Court made it official on May 26, 1857. As a free man, Scott found work as a hotel porter. Then, in September 1858, he died of tuberculosis. Harriett lived until June 1876 through the Civil War, the Emancipation Proclamation, and the 13th and 14th Amendments. Those two amendments abolished slavery and gave citizenship rights to all people born in the United States, respectively. The descendants of Dred and Harriett Scott still live in the St. Louis area to this day. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.